All right, guys. Today's topic, rational functions. All right, let's take a look at this. In the past classes, we studied these type of functions, right? The polynomial functions, right? Today, I'm sorry. Let me go back to this example. In one of these exercises for polynomial functions here. In one of these exercises, I ask you to find, or rather determine, which of these were polynomial functions and which of these were not polynomial functions, right? So we said the first one was a polynomial function, right? Second one was not a polynomial function. And we call these types of function, we call them radical functions. Why radicals? Because you have a root in here, so you call them radicals, right? And then these type of functions. This is the ratio of two polynomials. This is a rational function, again, because it is the ratio. In other words, rational functions are fractions. And that is exactly what we are going to study today. Let me just go all the way to the front. A little bit more. There, rational functions. So today we're going to study that. We're going to study fractions that have polynomials both on top and under. Let's take a look at rational functions. All right, so you guys know this, right? I don't know if you know this because some teacher explained it to you in seventh grade or sixth grade, but maybe you forgot it. So I'm just gonna read it, right? Ratios of integers are called rational numbers. So we have rational numbers, right? 1/2, 3/5. All of those are rational numbers. Why are those rational numbers? Because they are ratios, so fractionaries. Similarly, ratios of polynomial functions are called rational functions. So we have these examples. Look at this. We have a fraction. On top, we have a polynomial. And under, we have another polynomial. Polynomial over a polynomial. Polynomial over another polynomial. Those are the types of functions we are going to study today. All right? Those are the types of functions we are going to study. Now, how do we use the rational functions? It is absolutely simple. It is absolutely simple. How do we use this? Look, first let's take a look at what is a rational function, the definition. Now, this definition might look weird for you, but it is not. Look, here, rational function, in this example, we call it R of X. Remember, this is the name of the function, right? So this function is called R. Did you guys remember this? We saw this, I don't know, maybe every day, I don't know. Maybe at least every day in math, right? And look, it is a function, it is a fraction. On top, we have another function, we call it P. This is the name of the function, P. And down, another function, and we call it Q. So let's take a look in the chat, please. Answer this to me. Write down in the chat for this example that I have, I don't know, rounding with my mouse, with my cursor here. In the chat, write down, what is the function P? Let's see if you do it correctly or not. For this function. In the chat, please. Tell me, what is the function P? All right, we have one answer. Another answer. I have just two. Lunita saying, wait. Thank you, Sara. Give it a try, guys. Give it a try. This lets me know a couple of things. It lets me know if you are understanding what I'm saying, if you are paying attention to the slides, to the presentation, If you have any doubts, this let me know a lot of things. So give it a try, guys. Give it a try, please. Again, take a look at this function and tell me what is the function p. That's the question. All right. Oh, look at that. We have a lot of answers now. All right. We have a lot of answers now. All right, cool. So yes, the one on top, right? X squared minus 4, the one on top. Now, for the people who did not answer or didn't know, take a look at this. This is the form of every single rational function. One function over another function. The one on top, we call it P. The one under, we call it Q. So in this example, this was P. And this, the one under, we call it Q. All right, now take a look at this. Let's study what is the domain and the what is the domain of the rational function, the R. What is the domain of that? That is what we're going to study. Now, I know in the past, guys, some of you may have had difficulties with domain and range and all of that. I know that. I can see it in your faces right now. But if you give me the chance, I promised you, I can explain this in an easier way. And this domain range can be absolutely simple. All right, so take a look at this. The domain of the function is the set of all numbers. So let's begin with that. Every single number that exists is part of the domain. Voy a hacer un paréntesis aquí, de pronto debo arrancar por esto. ¿Qué es un dominio? Ok, no, pero es que no sé, no. Yo me acuerdo que vi eso en sexto, pero yo no me sé. Ok, mira, un dominio es un conjuntico de números. Son muchísimos números, muchos. ¿Cuáles? Muchos números que cumplen una característica. Entonces, cuando le dicen a uno, halle el dominio, anote esto, por favor, como una nota o algo así, porque se le va a olvidar, ¿listo? Si usted en este momento dice, mire, la verdad es que yo todavía no entiendo qué es dominio, pues entonces anótelo por ahí, anótelo. Dominio, cuando le dicen a uno, encuentre el dominio de la función, lo que le están pidiendo es, encuentre los numeritos que cumplen una característica. Eso es, escriba todos los numeritos que cumplen una característica. Eso es encontrar el dominio. ¿Ok? No es más. Escriba todos los números que cumplen una característica. ¿Ok? A medida que hagamos ejemplitos, nos vamos a dar cuenta de más dominios y cómo se escribe y ese tipo de cosas. Yo sé, mi niño, yo les entiendo que eso de dominio se ve feísimo y se lee feísimo y aparte se escribe feísimo. Pero como les dije, si me dan una oportunidad, les aseguro que se los explico un poquitín más fácil. ¿Está bien? Entonces, ¿qué es un dominio? Ok, pues un dominio es un conjunto de números. Son muchos números, muchos números. Ya está. But for this case, for the rational function, the domain are all the real numbers. So every single number that exists is part of that set, the domain. Now, we have some exceptions. We had some exceptions for that domain. Look at that. Except those for which the denominator is zero. So the function q, the denominator, is zero. All right? So every single number is part of the domain, but we have some exceptions. Which exceptions? We need to find those. All right? We need to
Profe.
Find... Yes.
Profe, es que Ricardo manda a decir que se le fue el internet.
I figure. Thank you, Pipe. I figure. I was seeing his camera and he just froze. I don't know what happened with the guy.
Listo, profe.
Pipe, why don't you do me a favor, please? Tell him if you can, of course, if you can, tell him to just take a look at the recording, all right?
Okay, mister.
Thank you, Pipe. All right, let's take a look at these. So we have two rational functions, all right? Let's take a look at this guy. So find the domain of the functions. Again, I already said, what is finding the domain? What is the idea behind finding the domain? Go ahead and tell me in the chat, please. According to what I just said, what did you understand? What did you understand? What is it that you have to do when finding the domain? Carlos, find the numbers that have a certain characteristic. Carlos, you are correct. I decided to read this aloud because you are perfect, brother. Thank you, Carlos. You're correct. Finding the domain is just telling a list of numbers. That's it. That is it. That is it. Thank you, Majo. All right, so we're going to do that here as well. Find the domain of the functions. Now, according to what we saw at the beginning, the domain of a rational function is every single number that exists. Look, is the set of all real numbers with some exceptions, right? With some exceptions. So the domain of this, let me just open bloc de notas. I think it's easier for me to write in bloc de notas. All right, so let's take a look at the first answer. Look, I'm going to write the first answer right there. Can you see it? All right, so what would be the domain? Let me write it here. Domain. Let me do it in capitals. Domain. All right, the domain will be simple. Will be all real numbers. That's it. Now, we have some numbers that we need to take out from here with exceptions, right? So the domain is all the real numbers. And again, I am writing this like this, all real numbers, because I could write it like this. I could write 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Right? I could do that. But then I also have to write the decimals. So I have to do 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, right? I have to continue. I can also include this one, 0.01 and 0.02 and 0.03. And can you get what I'm doing here? Writing the list of every single possible number. That is the idea behind domain. Let me write that. That is the idea behind the domain. That is the idea behind the domain. This telling a list of numbers, right? Finding the numbers that have a certain characteristic. That is the idea of a domain. But in this case, the domain is so incredibly big that we simply cannot write every single number individually. We have to come up with some characteristic. And that characteristic here is all real numbers. So by doing this little phrase in here, this sentence, I am writing every single possible number in the domain without having to actually type every single number. Did you get what I'm doing here? Okay, cool. All right. But let's take a look at this. Domain is the set of all real numbers except those for which the denominator is zero. Again, except those for which the denominator is zero. So if we go back here, we need to write some exceptions. All the real numbers except a couple of numbers, or maybe one or two or three numbers. The ones for which the denominator is zero. Okay, so this is the part where we actually have to think. It would be too easy in mathematics if all we have to do is write this domain, all the real numbers. That would be too easy, right? No. We have to think a little bit something, at least something. This is lower caps. All real numbers except what? what? Right, so let's take a look at this solution. A. We need to exclude the values for which the denominator is zero. Right? We need to exclude these numbers. Now, how is the denominator going to become a zero? Well, let's think about that. In mathematics, thinking about that means let's analyze that as an equation. So look, I want to find the values for which the denominator is zero. So simply, let's equal the denominator to zero. By doing this, if I isolate the denominator, the variable x, right? I am going to have those values. I'm going to find those values. Let's take a look. Here, the denominator is x plus 5, so I do x plus 5 equals 0. From here, isolate the variable x, so pass the positive 5 to subtract negative 5. Look at that. Now we know which values make the denominator 0. Just one value. In this case, just one value, negative 5. Negative 5. So if I come back to my domain, I can exclude that value now. Domain, all real numbers except negative 5. It is the domain right there. Right there. That is the domain. Remember, the domain is every single real number with some exceptions. The exceptions are the values for which the denominator is zero. So we need to find those. We need to find those. In this case, look, in this case, it's absolutely simple because if we replace x by negative 5, we have negative 5 plus 5, right? Negative 5 plus 5. So this becomes a zero. You see? So that is the value. That is the value we need to exclude. The negative 5. The denominator, the x, cannot be negative 5. Outside of that, the value x can take every other real number. That is the domain. That right there is the domain. Here, you write this in a quiz and you are good to go. All right, but there is also another way in which you can write this answer. It's called the set builder notation. Let's take a look at that. Like this. So again, let me be clear. You can write this in two ways. You can write this in my way. Can I increase format? No. Make this a little bit bigger. No, I can't. So sad. All right. So you can write this like this, right? With just regular words. So a sentence, the main, all real numbers except negative 5. Or you can write it as the set builder notation. I'm guessing this is why some of you had difficulties with domain, right, in the past, right? So you can choose both, really, guys. You can choose both, right? Now, me, as a mathematician, I love to write things in this format. So if you do it like this, you're going to have something special in my heart, a special place in my heart. But if you want to do it like this, guys, if you want to write your answers like this, this is correct. This is correct. This is correct. All right, let's take a look at this. Paso un momentico al español porque aquí se me pierde la gente. A propósito. Ethan, muy bien, papá. María Emma. So the numbers that make the denominator zero can't be in the domain. Yes, Emma. Emita, you are correct. The numbers that make the denominator zero cannot be on the domain. Perfect, Emita. So we exclude them. Yes, we exclude them, except negative 5. We exclude them. You are welcome, Emma. Ok, bueno, pues paso un momentico al español. Vamos a leer qué dice acá. Hay mucha gente que a veces se pierde un poquito aquí, entonces vamos a leerlo. Venga, a ver, recortes. Esto es, digamos, una forma de escribir en matemáticas como si se estuviera escribiendo en código. Esta partecita de aquí, esto significa cosas. Esto significa cosas. Entonces, póngale que vamos a dividir esto parte por parte, ¿listo? ¿Qué significa? Esto, cada uno de los simbolitos, y aquí, esto es simbolito, este simbolito, este simbolito. Cada uno de los simbolitos que hay aquí significan algo. Saber qué significa cada simbolito es saber leer la oración completa. Esto de acá es una oración. Esto de aquí es una oración. Solo que escrita en símbolo, en código. Ok, empecemos. El primer simbolito, este de acá. Este significa, es el conjunto de... A ver, es que si pudieran notarlo. Es el conjunto... Ay, conjunto de... Eso es lo que significa eso. Es en código. A los matemáticos nos encanta escribir de esta manera porque odiamos tener que gastar 2 horas escribiendo palabras. Odiamos eso. Así que escribimos en código. Aquí dice, es el conjunto de... Ok, pasemos a lo siguiente. La siguiente letrica que aparece significa algo. Aquí dice, es el conjunto de esta partecita. A ver, esta era la primera. Esta pongamos que aquí es la segunda. Eso significa los valores X. Los... No, los números. Números... Uy, es muy difícil escribir así, lo siento. Números X. Ahí está. Eso es lo que significa la siguiente. Hay veces en matemáticas escribimos cositas de otra manera. Por ejemplo, ponemos así, corchetico, Y. Pues aquí lo que dice es el conjunto de los números Y. Hasta ahí escribimos eso. Entonces mira que tiene un poquitín de utilidad, ¿no? En vez de escribir, es el conjunto de los números Y, hice 2 grabaticos. Ok. Borremos esto. Regresemos aquí al pasado. Ok. Vámonos con la siguiente. Esta linecita. ¿Qué significa esta linecita aquí? Esta linecita de acá. Esa linecita. ¿Qué significa? Ok, pues esa linecita significa tales que. Tales. Ahora, yo estoy seguro que algunos de ustedes entenderán qué quiero decir con tales que. Pero algunos de ustedes dirán, ¿cómo así? ¿Eso es el nombre de una persona? ¿Tales? No entiendo. ¿Cómo así? ¿Ahí qué dice? ¿Qué dice ahí, profe? Bueno, tales que significa que cumplen cierta característica. Entonces, si lo quieres leer en otras palabras, aquí dice, es el conjunto de los números X que cumplen cierta característica. Más bien, que cumplen la siguiente característica. ¿Sí? Eso es lo que dice ahí. Es el conjunto de los números X tales que. Ahora, siempre después de esa linecita, de esta linecita que voy ahí, de la linecita tales que, en inglés esto se lee such as, viene la característica. Aquí todo esto es la característica que cumplen los números. Aquí estoy diciendo que cumplen una característica, ¿no? Tales que. O sea, cumplen cierta característica. ¿Cuál es esa característica? La que escribimos después de la linecita. Y ahí, en esa característica, tenemos que leerla. Aquí dice, X no es, no puede ser, mira, eso es lo que dice ahí, no es igual, ¿no? Es el símbolo igual con una raya en el medio. O sea, que no puede ser. Si han visto, algunas veces aparece el símbolo de pare, ¿cierto? De parquear, perdón, con una raya, con una línea así, en la calle. ¿Se han visto ese? Bueno, pues todo el mundo entiende que esto es prohibido parquear, ¿no? Ok, pues es lo mismo, si pones el igual con una raya, pues es que no es igual. Es prohibido ser igual, es prohibido ser igual. ¿Y eso es lo que dice acá? Esos valores X no pueden ser negativo 5. Eso es lo que dice ahí, lo voy a tocar aquí. Característica, puntos suspensivos. No, me cansé. Ok, mis niños, eso es lo que dice ahí. Diferente de, muy bien, papá, Richie, gracias. Parrao, es el conjunto de los números X, tales que los números X sean diferentes a negativo 5. Muy bien, Parrao, muy bien. Entonces, en matemáticas, mira, escribir esa frasecísima toma tiempo. Odiamos los matemáticos escribir una cosa tan larga. Así que para eso se nos ocurrió el Set Builder Notation. Set Builder Notation no es más que una... Escribir en código. Una forma más cortita de escribir. Let's take a look at this one. What am I saying here? Can anybody read it in the chat, please? Anybody, read it in the chat, please. And now you're gonna think, what? Teacher, you explained it with this sign and now I have to, oh my God. I know. This is a challenge, right? You're gonna have to remember what are these two signs, right? What are these two signs? But I think you can make it. What am I reading here? What am I writing here? Now you can do it in Spanish or you can do it in English. It doesn't really matter. I can see what? Two people trying it in the chat? Give it a couple of minutes. Okay. Richie, you are correct. Congratulations. Sarita. Sarita, you are correct as well. Ethan. Ethan, you are correct. All right. Beautiful. The three of you guys are correct. Now, if you are interested in reading what these three people said, you can go ahead and read it in the chat, all right? So what it says here, it's pretty simple. This is the set of all the Z numbers, such as X is bigger than -3 and smaller or lower than 9. Beautiful. Bigger than -3. Lower than 9. Another way of saying this could be X is a value between -3 and 9. You can also say that if you want to. That's okay. You can also say so. Now, of course, this might look weird because I was saying that X is the value and the characteristic has to go with X. So I could do it here. I could do it with Z. Right? This makes a lot more sense because now I'm talking about the value Z and the value Z are the ones with the characteristic. But what I did at the beginning was still correct. With black. That is still correct. All right, so hopefully you guys have now the idea that domain is just a bunch of values that sometimes it's easier to set the values that are not included. All the real numbers except ones, right? The ones that are not included. And sometimes, again, instead of writing all these words, we just do it like this, writing in code. But it's still the same. Lunita, conjunto de los números Z, tal vez que sea mayor. Lunita, you're correct. Pretty good. All right, let's take a look at the second example, B. Example B. All right. What is the domain of that function? What is the domain of that function? Again, the domain of that function is the set of all the real numbers. But we have some exceptions. All the real numbers, but with some exceptions. Maybe just one or two or maybe five. I don't know, but some exceptions. And we have to find those exceptions. So we need to exclude the values for which the denominator is zero. We need to find those values so that we can exclude them from the domain, right? So what are those values? All right, let's think. What number do I put in X so that when I do this operation, becomes a zero? Okay, there's one pretty simple, right? If I do X equal 2, if I change the X by a 2, the value 2, I have 2 squared, that is 4, right? 4 minus 4, that is 0. All right, so we have one value. Look, we have one value already. Without having to do any mathematics, we know that one of the exceptions is 2, except 2. But is there another one? Is there another one? All right, sometimes we have to take advantage of what math teaches us. to be able to find those values. So let's take a look at this. Just like we did in the previous exercise, we are taking the denominator and equaling to zero. Once we isolate the variable, we are going to find those values that we need to exclude, right? So let's just isolate from here. The negative 4, I'll pass it to the other side as positive. And then the root, I'm sorry, the exponent, I'll pass it to the other side as a root. But remember, roots can be positive or negative, right? You guys remember this, right? Huh? So we have in here two possible values, positive 2 and negative 2. So now we know the domain was all the real numbers with some exceptions, 2 and negative 2. This is now the domain. All real numbers with some exceptions. That is the idea behind finding the domain. That is the idea behind finding the domain. All right? Also, you can, remember, you can write a domain like this, or you can write it using set builder notation. Take a look at this. The domain is the set of the numbers x such as x cannot or is different than negative 2, and x cannot be or is different than 2. Just that. Richie, you're correct, brother. And everybody else is correct. Lunita, Sara, Juan Sebastian, Ethan, Carlos, you guys are correct. Now, which way of writing the domain do you choose? That is up to you. You can do it like this or you can do it like this. Now, in the future, I will ask you to write domain in set builder notation. So doing this, in the future, I will ask you to do it like this because I want you to practice and get good at this, right? So eventually I'm gonna ask you to do this this way. But let's say now that we are beginning, we can just do it like this. All right, we have some exercises. Let's get to work. That is it for the class today. Let me just finish the recording. And remember, if you have any doubts, you can always ask me.